So the title of this first presentation is How has the Delta paper been used and what can we learn from that? I've deliberately put no author names under this title because implicitly the authors of this contribution are all the people who have contributed to the Delta paper. Let's summarize in one slide what was the most important message of that paper. All the mainstream DFT codes, when they are pushed to their ultimate numerical precision, lead to identical predictions for total energies and all quantities that depend on total energies. And strictly spoken, only for the PBE functional, because that is the one that had been tested. When writing that paper, we had in mind a kind of way in which people would cite it. So my ideal scenario would look like this. People write a paper and it's about calculations in the framework of DFT. So they cite the Homberg-Kohn and Kohn-Chan papers. That was done at the level of the PBE functional. So they cite the PBE paper. The calculations had been done with a particular DFT code, so you cite the default paper for that code. And it's a code you trust, in. It's a reliable implementation, and then you cite the Delta paper. That's the scenario I had in mind, and the purpose of the next 15 minutes is to find out, has this been realized or not? How do people actually cite it? It has been cited quite often so far. So Web of Science tells it has 300 citations since March 2016. That's one citation every 4 days, more or less. Not bad. Highly cited paper, which means it's in the 1% most cited physics papers that have been published in the same year. So not bad. The division over the different fields is like you see on this diagram. And I've not analyzed all 300 of these papers, but in order to be a little bit systematic, I've taken the two biggest categories, two of the intermediate categories, and the smallest category. And in every of these categories, I looked at the 10 most cited papers and the 10 most recent papers. So that was a collection of about 50 papers, and then try to find some systematics in that. So what are the ways in which people cite the Delta paper? The first category is one that is close to what we initially had in mind. You can cite it in order to emphasize that the DFT implementation you use is a reliable one. And in part, that DFT in general is a reliable method, and that your particular code is a reliable one too. Let's examine a few examples of this. You will always see a flash of the title of the paper. Maybe you recognize your own papers there. And then we zoom in to the place in the paper where the Delta paper has been cited, and it will always be highlighted in yellow. So here they have a statement, the reliability and predictive power of atomistic material simulations is increasing. And they use the Delta paper to emphasize, to prove that this reliability is indeed increasing. Another example, where it is used to make the point that my implementation is a good one. Hybrid DFT calculations were performed using the FHI AIMS all-electron code, a high-accuracy implementation of electronic structure theory. And the Delta paper is used to emphasize a high-accuracy implementation. I would have preferred to use there the word a high-precision implementation, because that is what the Delta paper really claims, but we get the meaning. And a third example, in this paper they say among all the different DFT codes, we have used the FPLO code, which is characterized by a high efficiency and at the same time it provides the most accurate numerical results. Again, the most precise numerical results. And they do not say that there are 10 other codes that offer the same level of precision, but okay, as such, the statement is not incorrect. My code is a good one. That's the way in which people can cite this. A category that I did not anticipate in that extent is that people can use this paper to document pseudopotentials. So either in general, the pseudopotential library that I'm using is as good as an all-electron calculation, or even as the default reference for a particular pseudopotential library. So let's look at a few examples of this. In this paper from Nature Nanotechnology, people state we use the quantum espresso distribution with SSSP pseudopotentials library, and this library has been tested. This library provides to date the best overall agreement with respect to all electron calculations, as proven in the Delta paper. Okay. NMR crystallography on something called furosemide goes along similar lines. Calculations were performed using a developer version of the CASTEP code, together with the CASTEP 9 set of ultrasoft pseudopotentials, and the Delta paper is used as the reference to that pseudopotential library. So it's immediately the existence of the pseudopotential library and its precision test in one citation. And that's similar in this paper, where they say at the bottom of the abstract, calculations performed with a norm-conserving scalar relativistic pseudopotential, and the Delta paper is used just to document this set. They don't specify exactly which pseudopotential set. You have to find it out from that paper. So using the Delta paper as a way to cite, to document the validity of your pseudopotential library, and even as the root reference of that pseudopotential library. Along similar lines, you can use it to document that a PAW set is as good as all electron calculations. And I show a few examples of that. People have used the PAW setup, which is called the 2012 VASP database. And at the bottom of this quotation, these PAW setups have been shown to yield very good agreement with respect to all electron calculations. And in this paper, it's similar. They have used PAW potentials for electron-ion interactions, which allows a significant reduction in computational time, and you achieve accuracy comparable to results of all electron calculations. Again, I would have preferred the word precision here rather than accuracy, but we get the meaning. Yet a different way to cite it is in a review on precision or accuracy studies. That's not totally unexpected. So let's show a few examples of reviews, also because these reviews in itself are often very much worth reading. This one here is a particularly good one from quantum chemistry. And they use the Delta paper as an example of a computational-only study. So you can compare with respect to experiments, but you can also compare method against method. And so different numerical strategies within a model family, that is where the Delta paper was used for. Atomistic calculations and materials informatics in a review. Here they have an entire paragraph about creating standard datasets for benchmarking in materials informatics, and the Delta approach is one of the examples there. Quantum crystallography. Again, a review where the approach that has been used in the Delta paper is discussed. So this shows that this message has been picked up by people who are writing reviews. And people, of course, want to go beyond what has been done in the Delta approach. That's the fifth category, follow-up studies on precision and accuracy, where often the Delta paper is cited as a starting point, and now we do something better. Like in this one, magnetocrystalline anisotropy of iron platinum, where they say the approach that has been used so far is mostly focused on total energies, equilibrium lattice parameters, and bulk moduli. And that's documented by a few papers, of which number four is the Delta paper. And now we go one step further to a quantity that is even more sensitive, which is the magnetocrystalline anisotropy. Machine learning as a way to predict converged numerical settings for a code. That's another aspect of precision. And also this is framed as a follow-up of the Delta approach. That's also an interesting one, a paper by Walls and Zunger about defect calculations. And they have the interesting statement that if you do defect calculations with different codes and compare them with each other, then the agreement is not always good. And this is not the case for defect-free bulk calculations. So everything is perfect if you have pure crystals, and the problems arise only when you start looking at impurities, was their message. So the hope was more or less to create a citation classic out of this Delta paper, a paper that everybody cites. Did we reach that goal yet? Well, if you look at the numbers, not completely. My list of the beginning, 30,000 papers for the DFT, 30,000 citations for the DFT papers. Remarkably, nearly 80,000 for PBE. I wasn't expecting that. That means there are many people citing PBE without referring to the core DFT papers. Interesting. And then we have this 300 citations. Of course, these other papers are a bit older, so we have to compare them in the same time frame. But even then, so also here remarkably, 25,000 PBE citations in the last 3 years, which is 5 times more than the DFT papers. So, but even in the same time frame, we are reaching less than 1% of the DFT publications. So there is still room for improvement. However, a citation classic is not always defined, not only defined by the fact that it has been cited by everyone. It is a citation classic once people start citing a paper without having read it. So can we find examples of that? Can we find inappropriate citations of the Delta paper? And they do exist as well. I show this one here. This is no critique on the quality of these particular papers, not at all, but let's see how they cite the Delta paper. They say here, the dominant point defects and their concentrations are determined from defect formation energies, which can be predicted with reasonable accuracy using DFT. Now, we didn't study defect formation energies in the Delta paper at all, and it was not about accuracy, it was about precision. So that's an inappropriate citation, I think. New frontiers for the materials genome initiative. What do they tell here? In addition to accelerating the discovery of functional materials, high throughput studies provide unique opportunities to improve the predictive accuracy of existing computational models. We didn't do anything about predictive accuracy. That is comparing to experiments. That was not done at all in the Delta paper. A third example. It's the statement between brackets. The interaction potentials are typically underestimated, resulting in larger lattice constants than those that are experimentally observed. It's about the PBE functional. Okay, if you take the data that are in that paper, you can come to that conclusion, but there are much better citations possible for that particular statement. So, 28 seconds left. I have to set the example and stay within the time. These are the six categories that I detected. Maybe you know others, so I would be interested to hear that during the discussion. To some extent, the initial ID has been realized. People cited to document the validity of this, their code, but the largest use is within proving the pseudo-potential validity. And that's then also a direction in which it is worth continuing. And you will see sessions specifically on pseudo-potential development. The timer is red. We switch to the next speaker, which will be Kurt.